Asma bint Umaysin, she said about Fatima binti Rasulillah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that Fatima, this is the shyness of the righteous women. This is the shyness of the people who've tasted the sweetness of Iman. This is the daughter of the Prophet alayhi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his own daughter. She said to Asma bint Umaysin, she said, Ya Asma'u, inni qad istaqbahtu ma yusna'u bin nisa'i. I feel distasteful, okay, that which is done to the women. I'm very distasteful towards what is done to the women. يطرح على المرأة الثوب فيصفها. The shroud is placed on the woman, her body, and it still shows her body parts.
This is a dead body.
This is a person who's passed away, who died. Fatima radiallahu anha, she's saying that this woman, when she dies, and they, she passed away, they placed a shroud on her, you can still see her body parts, her curves, and all of that. She's saying, I don't like it. It mentions, حجم أعضائها, whether her bones are big or not. So she didn't like that, radiallahu ta'ala anha. This shows you, subhanallah, it's the concept of haya, shyness. It was a sign of shyness. ولذلك, there was a woman from the Qisas al-Arab, from the stories of the Arabs that were mentioned, that her khimar fell off from her face. And she took her hand straight away to cover her face with her other hand. And then the poet, he said regarding her, سقطت النصيف. نصيف, it means the khimar. سقط النصيف ولم ترد إسقاطه فتناولته واتقتنا باليد. Her khimar fell from her face and she didn't intend for it to fall. But what she did was, فتناولته واتقتنا باليد. So she took her other hand to cover her face. And I remember, subhanAllah, one of the things that took me back, when I went back to my country, Somalia, and I saw the Somali girls that go to school. By the way, some schools are, but the school I was going to was segregated. Boys and girls were segregated. But if it ever happened that the boys and the girls had to leave the gates, and they, you saw a girl leaving, and the boy, you would always see the following. It was something very common, subhanAllah, it took me back. That even though they're not wearing niqab, but because they're wearing big jilbabs, they take the side of the jilbab, they've got their hand inside, and they cover it over their faces for no one to see them.
Right.
So it's, subhanAllah, it's a noble characteristic. So Allah, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I ask Allah from the bottom of my heart that He increases this in our Muslim women.
Amen.
The third reason why the niqab was, or the hijab in general, is sanctioned is because it protects the woman. الحجاب حماية للنساء من أذى الفاسقين. The hijab is a thing that protects the women from the harms of the transgressors and the criminals. We know we're not living in a perfect world where there's righteous people, right, left, center. There are criminals here. We're talking about thugs. We're talking about rapists. We're talking about evil people. Our religion wants to protect our women. It doesn't want our women to fall into these problems. Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, He says, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّبِيُّ قُلْ لِأَزْوَاجِكَ وَبَنَاتِكَ وَنِسَاءِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ يُدْنِينَ عَلَيْهِنَّ مِنْ جَلَابِيبِهِنَّ ذَلِكَ أَدْنَى أَنْ يُعْرَفْنَ فَلَا يُؤْذَيْنَ وَكَانَ اللَّهُ غَفُورًا رَحِيمًا. Allah says, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّبِيُّ, O Prophet of Allah, say to your wives and your daughters and the believing women, يُدْنِينَ عَلَيْهِنَّ مِنْ جَلَابِيبِهِنَّ, that they cover themselves with their jilbab. ذَلِكَ أَدْنَى أَنْ يُعْرَفْنَ فَلَا يُؤْذَيْنَ. This is a means for her not to be recognized and not harmed. فَلَا يُؤْذَيْنَ وَكَانَ اللَّهُ غَفُورًا رَحِيمًا. And verily Allah is one who is very forgiving and merciful to His creation. So the ayah says فَلَا يُؤْذَيْنَ. And the word فَلَا يُؤْذَيْنَ is دَلَالَةٌ وَاضِحَةٌ. It's a clear-cut evidence على أن الجلباب أو الحجاب حارس أمين ومانع قوي من أذى الفساق وأهل الشهوات. It's a clear-cut evidence that the word فَلَا يُؤْذَيْنَ is a means. That means the hijab and the jilbab is a means that protects the woman from the people who have desires, who want to harm her. Last but not least, the fourth one is that it protects the men and the women, both of them, from falling into what? من الوقوع في فاحشة الزنا. It protects the man and the woman from falling into zina. So this woman, she meets a man. In order for him to have any sexual intercourse with her, first of all, the clothes have to go off. No one has sexual intercourse with clothes on. ولذلك الله تبارك وتعالى, He said in the ayah, وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا الزِّنَا إِنَّهُ كَانَ فَاحِشَةً وَسَاءَ سَبِيلًا. Do not come close to zina, for verily it is a evil thing. It's a fahisha, it's a crime, and it's an evil thing. The ayah says, وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا الزina. Don't come close to zina. The ayah did not prohibit from عن مجرد فعله. It didn't prohibit us from merely doing the action of zina. It didn't. It said, don't get close to zina. So this is النهي عن قربانه. It's getting, it's a prohibition of getting closer to zina, not just the action of zina itself. And this is powerful. It's more greater. Why? Because anything that would lead to zina is closed, which is what the scholars call سد الذرائع. All those evil means, they have to be blocked off. So we're not allowed to look at a woman, have to lower our gaze because it's protecting us from zina. We're not allowed to, a woman is not allowed to wear hijab that shows her, she's not allowed to wear clothing that shows her body parts, or she's not allowed, yani, all of that is going to lead to zina. And subhanAllah, just as a final point I want to conclude with, that women are objectified when they wear, you know, less clothes. Yani, the less clothes that she wears, the less, the more revealing she is, the more skin that's displayed, the more the woman is objectified. And she's seen less intelligent, and she's also belittled and degraded. And this is, subhanAllah, something, as Allah tabarak wa ta'ala said in the Quran, وَشَهِدَ شَاهِدٌ مِّنْ أَهْلِهَا. They themselves, the non-Muslims, have testified to this in surveys that they've done, researches that they've done. Yani, they've looked at this matter, by the way, not just, they've looked at it from a neurological perspective, psychological perspective. Why are psychologically men like this? If a woman comes with a miniskirt, they objectify her straight away. They don't just objectify her, they dehumanize her. They take that value of her being a human being from this woman. I was taken back, various studies, by the way, I've come across ample studies that point towards how external cues that the women, or such as her appearance, for example, and the attire that she wears could play a key role in encourages objectification, dehumanization, and the denial of any intellectual grounds. I mean, this is researches that the non-Muslims. In April, in April 1999, a survey by the Janet News Service, they revealed that almost one in three people in the US believe that the behavior or dress of a woman plays a role of her being a rape victim, and it can contribute to the act of a rapist just because of what? This is a big number. One person is saying, I believe that the reason why women get raped is because of the clothing they're wearing. By the way, I have to put this out. No woman deserves to be raped, even if she takes off all of her clothes and she's naked and she's wearing nothing. No one deserves to be raped. No one deserves to be harmed. Just because, you know, a woman dressed in a certain way does not in any way, shape or form allow a rapist to rape her. I'm not justifying rapists. And they do deserve a very serious dealing, rapists. Yani, they should be dealt with seriously. And it's not something I would love for my sister or my mother or however way they act.
Yeah.
With that being said, though, we need to take our precautions. This is what the point is. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala says to us in the Quran, خُذُوا حِذْرَكُمْ. Take your precautions. In 1978, by the way, I like that I'm going backwards. I'm not talking about now when...
Yeah, that's true. That's true. You said 1999 first time, 1978.
These are like, subhanAllah, surveys and, you know, researches that were done early. I want to show when people were more modest, people were more honest, people were more... The social media and what it's done, subhanAllah, it's become crazier. In 1978, sexual assault cases, there was a sexual assault case that took place in the Montana Supreme Court. They noted out that the defendant testified that the sexual conduct, the rapist, he testified that the reason why he committed this was encouraged by the dress and behavior of the woman he raped. He goes, I wasn't going to do it. News reports provided accounts of instances in which the victim's clothing were introduced into evidence in a courtroom. Yani, they took their clothing just to check what was the reason why the rapist did it. Yani, the non-Muslims are even saying this. So if a sister believes that the more skin she shows, if she believes the more she gets rid of her hijab, that she's going to be respected, increased skin display was not self-rated as modest. Yani they did a survey. Mm-hmm. They said increased skin display was not self-rated as modest. No one from all of the participants that participated in the survey, yani few said it, the number was so low. Women expecting high levels of investment, act of chast, emphasize of their fidelity, whereas women who do not expect investment, if a woman wanted to be respected for her chast, her brain, yeah, and her intellect, she wanted to be respected for how she carries herself, she covered more.
Mm.
This is this research they did. And women who did not expect to be emotionally invested with her, or intellectually invested with her, she flaunted the sexuality to extract the pre-reproduction, you know, investment from as many males as possible. In other words, she's playing into men's desires.
Right.
She wants to be respected for her looks. And this is, subhanAllah, you as a person telling men to objectify you, dehumanize you, and then you get, you know, you get that response from men. There's no ihtiram for you. You see? I remember, subhanAllah, very strongly, I was in college and a girl must have, and it got too close to a boy, and what he did to her was he touched her in an inappropriate way. He touched her in an inappropriate way. And subhanAllah, the girl, of course he has no rights to. He has no rights to. This is wrong. This is unequivocally wrong. But what I sensed from it was the fact that she acted in that way gave him the impression that she would not mind if he did this.
Mm.
Do you understand my point?
Yeah,
it's as though she invited this. And so when she got angry and she said, "Oh, you just why did you touch me in an inappropriate way? Why did you do that?" When she responded in that way, and she said what she said, his jaw dropped. Like, where did that come from? I thought we could do what we want to each other.
Right.
Again, I'm not saying that what he did was right, and I'm not justifying that. I have to keep putting that there. But I'm just trying to say to you, human psychology is like that. If you show more skin, if this is the way the world. You take a piece of meat and you place it on top of a tree. Lions see it. They're not going to let it go. They're going to eat that piece of meat. You leave it in the desert. You leave it in the jungle. And again, I'm not saying a woman is a piece of meat. Again, I am not comparing a piece of meat to a woman. But what I'm saying is, what I'm comparing is, being lackadaisical in a situation, yani exposing yourself out like that, same way as exposing your you don't leave your phone outside and expect no one to steal it. I'm just comparing, just being lackadaisical, you know, not being considerate, not knowing that your actions
can lead to a reaction.
Yeah,
I understand.